Hello, it's Friday, July 1st here in Manila. I'm Stanley Palisada giving you the head start for the day. Our guest for Hot Copy, we have Albay Representative Joey Salceda as we get his reaction to President Marcos' inaugural address. We'll also talk about the economic prospects under the new administration. But first, the headlines. Today's big stories: foreign diplomats congratulate and vow support for the new Philippine President Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. Marcos's predecessor, Rodrigo Duterte, returns to his hometown, Davao. And the Philippines logged its highest daily COVID-19 tally in over 4 months. Newly installed Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. sends a message of hope and unity during his inaugural address. It also gave a preview of his priorities and paid tribute to the two-decade rule of his father. Willard Cheng reports.
At exactly 12 noon, Ferdinand Romualdez Marcos Jr. took his oath as the 17th President of the Philippines before Chief Justice Alexander Gesmundo.
Ako, si Ferdinand Romualdez Marcos Jr.
Si Ferdinand Romualdez Marcos Jr.
ay mataimtim na nanunumpa.
Ay taimtim na nanunumpa.
Natutuparin ko ng buong katapatan at sigasig.
Natutuparin ko na buong katapatan at sigasig
ang aking mga tungkulin.
Ang aking mga tungkulin
bilang Pangulo ng Pilipinas.
Bilang Pangulo ng Pilipinas.
After signing his oath of office, the new commander-in-chief was given a 21-gun salute. At the start of his inaugural address, President Marcos acknowledged the mandate he received during the elections and explained why he chose not to respond to rivals during the campaign, focusing instead on his message of unity.
By your vote, you rejected the politics of division. I offended none of my rivals in this campaign. I listened instead to what they were saying. And I saw little incompatibility with my own ideas about jobs, fair wages, personal safety, and national strength, and ending want in a land of plenty.
Marcos admitted the huge responsibility that comes with the presidency and called for cooperation, while also recalling his father and namesake, President Ferdinand Edralin Marcos.
I once knew a man who saw what little had been achieved since independence in a land of people with the greatest potential for achievement. And yet, they were poor. But he got it done, sometimes with the needed support, sometimes without. So will it be with his son. You will get no excuses from me.
Marcos identified the most pressing problems he is facing, such as the pandemic and the effects of the war in Ukraine. He says a comprehensive plan for economic transformation is currently being drawn up.
Your dreams are mine. Pangarap nyo ay pangarap ko. How can we make them come true? How can we do it together? But I will take it as far as anyone with the same faith and commitment can, as if it depended entirely on himself. Sa pangarap na maging mapayapa ang ating bansa, ang pangarap nyo ay pangarap ko.
Among issues that need urgent attention, Marcos singled out the agriculture sector and the need to ensure food sufficiency, the problem in the supply of oil, and the quality of education. But Marcos stressed he is not out to revise history.
What we teach in our schools, the materials used must be rethought. I am not talking about history. I am talking about the basics, the sciences, sharpening theoretical aptitude and imparting vocational skills, such as in the German example, alongside the national language, with equal emphasis and facility in a global language, which we had and lost.
Marcos spoke of the need to assist overseas Filipino workers and teachers, and underscored the role of Vice President Sara Duterte, who will also serve as Education Secretary. Marcos has a critique on the COVID response and vowed to fix the public health system.
There were shortcomings in the COVID response. We will fix them. out in the open. No more secrets in public health. Remember, I speak from experience. I was among the first to get COVID.
Marcos vowed to continue infrastructure programs, citing the role of his father and predecessor Rodrigo Duterte in building roads.
My father built more and better roads, produced more rice than all administrations before his. President Rodrigo Roa Duterte built more and better than all the administrations succeeding my father's. Following these giant steps, we will continue to build. I will complete on schedule the projects that have been started. I'm not interested in taking credit. I want to build on success that's already happening. We will be presenting the public with a comprehensive infrastructure plan. 6 years could be just about enough time. No part of our country will be neglected. Progress will be made wherever there are Filipinos, so no investment is wasted.
Marcos vowed action to address pollution and the effects of climate change. Marcos claimed building the windmills in Ilocos Norte.
We have yet to see large-scale practical solutions to pollution, though some are beginning to emerge. But there are tried and proven new ways of mitigation. Blades have been turning over the sand dunes of Ilocos Norte, harnessing a power all around, but unseen, long before this day. I built them.
The Bangi windmills were developed and constructed by the North Wind Power Development Corporation. In the end, Marcos expressed willingness to sacrifice in his decision-making and closed with a message of hope.
Believe. Have hope. The sun also rises like it did today and as it will tomorrow. And as surely as that, we will achieve the country all Filipinos deserve. God bless the Philippines. God bless our work. Maraming salamat po sa inyong lahat. Mabuhay ang Pilipinas.
In the inaugural address, President Marcos gave a preview of his priorities. How he intends to address them will be laid out, he said, in his State of the Nation address in July. Willard Cheng, ABS-CBN News.
Chinese President Xi Jinping ready to work with the Philippines' new leader. In his congratulatory letter, Xi told Ferdinand Marcos Jr. that he is willing to work with him to continue writing a great chapter of China-Philippine relations. Chinese Vice President Wang Qishan, who represented Xi during Thursday's inauguration, also presented a four-point proposal to enhance bilateral ties. According to Chinese state media CCTV, Marcos told Wang that Beijing was Manila's most powerful partner and that his administration is willing to deepen the country's participation in China's Belt and Road Initiative. There was no mention of China's increased military activities in disputed waters, but Japanese Foreign Minister Yoshimasa Hayashi also met with Marcos and said the Philippine leader has agreed to cooperate with Tokyo to maintain and reinforce, perhaps, rules-based maritime order. Hayashi added Japan will support the Philippines' effort to enhance equipment of its Coast Guard. Other foreign diplomats personally congratulated President Marcos Jr. at a post-inaugural reception at the National Museum. The papal envoy spoke on behalf as the Dean of the Diplomatic Corps to pledge cooperation with his administration.
The Filipino people have placed their trust and their hopes in you, their hopes for a future that is prosperous, safe, equitable, and just. We too, in the international community, harbor the same hopes for your presidency and for your nation, and that we pledge our cooperation and collaboration with your administration in achieving the success of your mandate.
Marcos expressed gratitude to foreign governments for seeking to boost ties with the Philippines under his leadership.
We can only go from here to strength and to strength and to strength.
And for that, that is what I look forward to, that the day will come when we can say that we have built upon the strong foundation that we came upon.
Philippine President Marcos Jr. carries out his first official act by swearing in his cabinet members and newly elected officials of his home province of Ilocos Norte. Among those sworn into office, the president's eldest son, Vivian Gulia, with the details.
The rain did not dampen the mood of newly sworn-in Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., who returns to Malacañang 36 years since his family fled the palace. He was welcomed with arrival honors at the Kalayaan grounds Thursday afternoon, with some workers waving small Philippine flags. Marcos was accompanied by wife Lisa and three sons as he went up Malacañang's grand staircase, a symbol of his ascent to the highest post in the country. At the palace, Marcos administered the oath to his cabinet members.
I suppose this is the first act of actual work that we will be doing for this administration. So let's get the official part done so that we can get on with the job. I, your name, having been appointed to the position of...
Most of his cabinet secretaries, except for those who have yet to be appointed, took the oath. Marcos has yet to name his health and energy secretaries. He also does not have a foreign affairs chief yet. The oldest member of the cabinet, presidential legal advisor Juan Ponce Enrile, was diagnosed with COVID-19 on Monday and skipped Marcos's inauguration. The president also led the oath-taking ceremony of local officials from Ilocos Norte, where his family hails. These include his son Sandro, who was elected representative of Ilocos Norte's 1st District.
So help me God.
So help me God.
This was my doing because I insisted that this is a very important chance for me. When else will I be able to swear in as president our mayors, our congressmen, and our officials from Ilocos Norte?
Don't cry.
Marcos's family and cabinet members also took part in the inaugural dinner held at 7 p.m. in Malacañang. The event is not open for media coverage. The president wore a barong created by Pepito Albert. After the celebrations, actual work starts, and President Marcos said he will offer no excuses as he vowed to deliver on his promises and implement changes that he said will benefit everyone. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
Now, former Philippine Budget Secretary Rolando Andaya Jr. passed away Thursday. He was 53. Andaya's children announced his death on social media but did not specify the cause. Andaya once served as Camarines Sur representative. He lost his bid to become Camarines Sur governor in the May elections. Andaya previously made headlines when he suggested that then Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte could run for president with former Defense Chief Gilbert Teodoro as her running mate. He later backed the presidential bid of former Vice President Lenny Robredo. Joining us now on Hot Copy, we have Albay Representative Joey Salceda. Good morning, sir, and welcome to Head Start.
Good morning.
All right. First, let's get your reaction on the passing of former Budget Secretary and, of course, fellow Bicolano Rolando Andaya Jr. Well,
he was my good friend, and we worked together under President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, essentially handling fiscal matters. So it's truly sad, especially after he also lost his wife, and then, of course, now it's himself. So nakakalungkot kasi he's a stalwart of the national budgeting process.
All right. Thanks a lot, Mr. Salceda. Moving on now, President Marcos, Ferdinand Marcos Jr., was sworn in as president yesterday. And in his speech, there was a lot of acknowledgement of economic headwinds and perhaps broad strokes on how he intends to weather through the crisis. Now, have you heard the speech, and which portions of it gave you a sense that, of course, he was in the right direction as far as tackling those economic challenges?
Well, on the whole, of course, you know, it's an inaugural speech, so you don't expect much of the details, but rather the broad strokes, the acknowledgement of the challenges as well as the opportunities. And it's very clear that there were three themes to it. One, of course, is his insistence on unity. Second, his big mandate for sweeping changes. And third is, of course, there is that attempt to when the government issue, in other words, the government being an instrument of the people, and that the government is an instrument for a better future. So, I mean, basically, those were the three themes that bound the entire speech yesterday.
All right. Now, describe to us, perhaps in your own view, just how possibly overwhelming a challenge is President Marcos facing in terms of the economy, and what should he address first as far as the economy is concerned? We know there's a lot. I mean, it's a bag full of problems, but which must be his priority?
Inflation. Pero kitang-kita naman natin agad na naghahanap na ng budget para makapagbigay ng ayuda, kasi yung sabi niya, we are blameless doon sa pag-akyat po ng presyo po ng trigo at pag-akyat po ng presyo ng gasolina. So, ang ibig sabihin nito, kailangan tulungan ng unahin ng gobyerno, tulungan yung mga mahirap. At pangalawa, just make sure that there is food on the table, especially given the protectionist patterns in the global markets. So I think that was pretty clear that he will engage, but that will be medium to long term with respect to what I said, sufficiency in food in an age of plenty, basically. So there are two things there. Plenty may mean sacrificing efficiencies, because there's also an option that you can just import all of it, impose tariffs, and then essentially use the proceeds of the tariff to help the poor or the farmers. So, or you can spend government resources in trying to help what is essentially an inefficient agricultural sector. So, pero para sa akin kasi, pag tiningnan mo yung speech niya, may short term siya na hindi nakita ng tao eh. Lagi niya ini-insist na malaki ang nawala sa Pilipinas dahil sa pandemic.
Right.
Kinuwenta ko na sa 6.23 trillion ang nawala. This includes the notional growth in 2020 and 2021, as well as actual losses because of the lockdowns, the ECQs, and of course the money that we need to protect. Essentially, we need to spend while the revenues are not coming in. So, yes. Yung isang kumbaga sa ano, tinakal niya yon. Pero yung isang problema, yung economic headwind nga, dahil sa buong mundo, umaakyat po ang interest. So pag kinontent analysis mo yung speech niya, the word debt only appears one time. It's called debt of gratitude. I went through his speech so many times.
Right.
And I was looking for an acknowledgement that the 13 trillion, possibly 13.7 trillion debt, and given that a lot of it is foreign, and therefore is you need to refinance it externally. And given the fact that the U.S. Fed needs to raise rates a lot more in order to control inflation, and in short, that's forgivable because I think he will deal with it in the proper time. I think as the cabinet actually sitting down already with respect to an economic transformation program.
All right. Now, a lot of sectors, of course, are saying that Mr. Marcos is inheriting ballooning debt from the COVID-19 pandemic response. You're saying this can be serviced through loans from other countries. Is there any other way that he can handle this, aside from loans and borrowing, further borrowing?
The first one, of course, is collection efficiency. Organically, if you look at the Philippines, I've been in charge of the Committee on Waste and Means, and my job has been to look for money for this country. And for the past 6 years, so you see that tax to GDP has increased even without new measures by 0.3% per year. So you can, that immediately gives you about 60 billion. So, and nominally, if you grow the economy by 6%, then that would add about another tax take of 10%, 200, so additional 200 billion. And then, so you can start with those two things. And then if there are taxes that we call Pigovian in nature, and these are taxes that do not hurt the poor, like taxing everybody who goes to the casinos mm-hmm. every time they go, they come in, taxing, you know, if you bet on a player, not just on banker, you can easily raise about 98 billion. There are several measures already, which the speaker has actually sought the soft copy from my office, and basically is filing some of these key measures that will increase at least revenues, organic revenues, by 200 billion on top of, you know, the program.
All right, let's talk about taxes further in a different light. Amid the global economic bump, you are proposing the use of train revenue to fund social amelioration and perhaps cushion the impacts or the direct impacts of the crisis on a lot of sectors. Please tell us about Katas ng Train, and are you optimistic that the new Marcos administration will consider something stopgap as that?
I think so. Yun ang sabi niya, di ba? Na yung na blameless ang Pilipinas pagdating po sa pag-akyat ng gasolina sa buong mundo. At pangalawa, yung pag-angat po ng presyo ng commodities. So ang pinaka moral imperative niya, sabi niya, is food. And how do you get food without money, without access? So ang uunahin mo is inflation ayuda. And I think this is the first innovation that he will put into place, because before we had ayuda against COVID, etc. Now we have inflation ayuda for the lowest 50%, and I think we have been able to identify 30 billion to essentially aid the lowest 50% at 500 pesos per month. This is 12.4 million families, plus of course the heavily impacted sectors, especially fishing, where 50% of the total cost is actually fuel. You have, of course, farmers, and of course the transport sector. Although the transport sector had some relief, but this is the second round effect of an inflation. They were given a fare hike of 2 pesos. So, but this will this is a second round effect, because workers have been given at least in 14 regions by an average of 5 to 7% increase in minimum wages. Right. So I think it's a little tricky, but I think we still have fiscal and resource space for policy maneuvers.
Yes, it's challenging because on the one hand, you have a crisis that you have to deal with, and yet you have to sustain growth that has been there for years. Like his predecessor, President Duterte, President Marcos also hinted his plan to continue Mr. Duterte's infrastructure push much more now. Although, again, in broad strokes, realistically, can these be achieved in 6 years, considering that much of it, the country will still be under pandemic recovery mode?
Una-una, nagkaroon tayo ng massive structural transformation. Hmm. Yung Public Services Act, yung Foreign Investments Act, right. Yung Retail Trade Liberalization Act, yung CREATE. These were very contentious policy issues that are now, you know, well within, that are policy instruments well within the use of the new president. So kailangan lang ma-market ito. Pangalawa, kailangan, sabi niya mismo din, na tapusin muna yung mga sinimula na mga big ticket projects ng under the Build program. So ang isang leeway doon, of course, I think there is greater predisposition in the new administration to public-private partnership, or PPP, which was totally disavowed by the Duterte administration. So there is a leeway there. So as you said, one, tax collection efficiency.
Right.
Second is, of course, what you can call non-regressive taxes. And three, basically, you can have PPP, basically. Mm-hmm. And number four is foreign direct investments. Although, of course, mas critical po sa Pilipinas ang public goods. In other words, kung si Ayala ang magpapagawa ng kalsada, o ang gobyerno magpapagawa ng kalsada, pag si Ayala, siguro mga 1.3 times lang ang multiplier. Pero pag ang gobyerno ang papagawa ng kalsada, ang multiplier 3.7 times kasi public good siya. So kailangan po pa rin natin na yung ating pong infrastructure as percentage of GDP should be retained at above 5 or at least closer to 5.4%. I think I've looked at the fiscal program for 2023 that will be presented to Congress by August. So I think nandun naman. And the sixth option, of course, is privatization.
All right. Representative Salceda, President Marcos has taken a liking for agriculture sector, having mentioned it as essential in the nation's push for food sufficiency. Now, given that landscape has changed so much in the country in the past decades, agriculture is not as strong as it used to. And for much of our agriculture dominance, is it still recoverable?
I think he has plenty, he has a very cohesive and very strong and competent economic team. So the challenge there is, would you rather spend 100 billion, let's say, on agriculture rather than, you know, allowing imports, cheaper imports, like cheaper rice from Vietnam and cheaper rice from Thailand. So, and use the money to directly improve the farmers' cost efficiencies, lalong-lalo na may kasama pa ng mga 17 billion yan na taripa. So I think they will strike a balance there. So, pero pag binasa ko na maigi, yung konsepto niya ng food security appears to be to produce more of what we eat as Filipinos. So, right. Ibig sabihin yan, rice at saka ibang basic food communities, so commodities. So may isang, hindi lang ako masyadong komportable yung pagkasabi niya, although I think may be true. He said this, that comparative advantages appear not to work during crises such as the Ukraine conflict. In the short term, I think it may be true, but in the long term, I think his economic team will definitely have to deal with this policy dilemma.
And can you are you confident that he has the resolve? Of course, this was a campaign promise, at least part of it, was reducing the price of rice.
Alam mo, sa mga presidente kasi, ang mga Marcos, pati si Presidente Duterte, sila yung may kakayahan na mag-articulate ng grand national ambition. Alam mo, pag tinignan mo yung 20 pesos per rice, 20 pesos kilos per kilo rice, it's, well, of course, they're trying to tone it down as being aspirational. But I look at it basically as his attempt to basically make food available, accessible to the poor. And therefore leads to nutrition, and nutrition leads to better education. Better education leads to basically better and higher competitiveness. So you need to take this as yung 20 pesos per kilo as an articulation of a grand national ambition to make the Philippines essentially food secure and essentially competitive. So hindi ako na you should not focus too much on the, well, is rhetoric. 20 pesos doable or etc. But it's really that predisposition of this new president to go for a grand national ambition. Yan po yung 20 pesos per kilo.
All right, lastly, now a few times during his 25-minute speech, President Ferdinand Marcos, of course, had told Filipinos to leave it up to his government to work on the challenges, including economic recovery. He assured that no one will be left out. Now, do you find this reassuring given the lack of platform or strategy still?
Tingin ko it will be well clarified. You can go back to a lot of his pronouncements. First, personnel is policy. So you look at the kind of personnel he has already chosen. And anin ba yung mga wala pa? Energy, health, at saka foreign affairs. So makikita mo kagad na filled up na yung mga economic departments. Except for energy. So doon mo kagad makikita ko ano yung ang kanyang mga priority. Pangalawa, yung pagpili niya bilang sekretary siya mismo ng agriculture. So at I went through the entire campaign pronouncements, and you can immediately see his predisposition towards agriculture and essentially food security. Mm. And I think exactly naman, you know, Ukraine produces 30% of wheat of the entire world, and in this country, yung pandesal has no substitute basically. So talagang nakadepende ka sa imports. So para sa akin yung kanyang paghawak ng agrikultura, ng portfolio ng agrikultura ay ano, at saka siyempre marami pa siyang ibang sinabi sa energy, basically the focus on indigenous energy, on education, hindi na yung sabi niya, hindi naman ako interesado diyan sa historical revisionism, sabi niya. Mas interesado ako, actually may mga final ako ng bill nung palito eh, yung German model sa, para sa high school na kung saan eh, yung mga technical and vocational skills are being taught very early. I think on the whole, there is enough already guidelines or guidance for Filipinos to be more hopeful under the BBM administration.
And lastly, what is your wish, perhaps, or marching order for the president in the next 6 years? What are your expectations?
Of course, alam mo yung una, panindigan lang niya yung isang sinabi niya na yung 6.2 trillion na nawala sa atin dahil sa COVID, bawiin niya in the next 18 months. I think
that's good enough.
That's my marching order to him because he himself has said it. Although people did not give it too much, He kept not romanticizing naman the losses arising from the pandemic. But if you put a number to it, it's roughly 6.3 trillion na nawala sa atin in nominal terms due to the pandemic. So I think the strategy as well as the tactical maneuvers, either through fiscal policy or through mesoeconomic policies like industrial development, agricultural development, and service promotion, I think kaya naman po yun ma-achieve.
All right. On that note, thanks a lot, Representative Joey Salceda. It's always good to talk to you.
Salamat din.
Good morning. We'll take a quick break. Head Start. We'll be right back. Back 3 decades after they were forced into exile, the Philippines' most famous political dynasty returns to the peak of power. Sandro Ochona traces the Marcos family's successful journey towards reclaiming control of the Philippines.
It's been 36 years since the late dictator Ferdinand Marcos Sr. was ousted in 1986. But after nearly 4 decades, the Marcos family is back in Malacanang. DLSU political science professor Julio Tihanki sees Marcos Jr.'s oath of office as historical, vowing to defend a constitution crafted after his father was removed from office.
Ang tanong, palalakasin ba ni Bongbong Marcos ang 1987 constitution or magiging hudyat ba ito ng pagtatapos ng ikalimang republika sa ilalim ng 1987 constitution?
For historian Xiao Chua, there are two sides to the Marcos legacy.
May dalawang aspekto yung panguluhan ng dating Pangulong Marcos, yung tatay. May aspekto na malupit, may kamay na bakal, di ba? Pero may aspekto na naaalala ng marami, kaya nga yun ang ini-invoke na halal sila, yung mga proyekto.
After a nearly six-year exile in Hawaii, the Marcoses were allowed to return home in 1991. The following year, Imelda Marcos ran but lost her presidential bid. While Bongbong Marcos won as the representative for the 2nd District of Ilocos Norte. In 1995, he entered the Senate race but lost. 3 years later, Bongbong Marcos was elected as governor of Ilocos Norte, a position he held for 3 terms until 2007. On that same year, he ran and won a district congressman, and finally securing a Senate seat in 2010. However, he again tasted defeat when he tried to seek the vice presidential post. But fast forward to 2022, Bongbong Marcos earned an overwhelming mandate to be the Philippines' 17th president. He, however, will be facing numerous challenges stemming from the pandemic and economic difficulties due to the Ukraine crisis.
Bagsak ang ating ekonomiya pero hindi pa rin tayo tapos sa pandemya. Kailangan talaga yung sure and safe exit from the pandemic. And then how do you address the scarring in the economy?
Ano yung gagawin mo sa mga krisis? Yun yung first 100 days. So at yung State of the Nation address na darating, yung unang sona niya, yun ang magseset sa atin. Ano ba yung magiging takbo ng administrasyon na ito?
Another issue that some observers are looking at is how President Marcos will deal with surviving victims of martial law.
Dapat mamulat tayo, dapat magmasig tayo. We should be aware and we should keep on monitoring all the time. Yun. Kaya ito ang kahalagahan ng ginagawa namin sa ngayon.
Inaasahan ko na sa susunod na mga araw, mga linggo, at mga buwan, ipapakita nila sa pagsuporta, sa pagkilos laban sa korupsyon, laban sa pagtaas ng presyo ng bilihin, at laban sa pagsikil sa ating mga kalayaan.
Papahayag.
And as President Marcos was sworn in, these victims, along with some youth groups, held their own oath-taking, determined to continue seeking justice and truth. Zandro Ochona, ABS-CBN News.
The Marcos inauguration described by major international news agencies as a stunning political comeback for one of the most famous political dynasties in the Philippines and Asia. Al Jazeera observes Thursday's inaugural event was far grander than that of past Philippine presidents. The BBC points out it marks the culmination of a decades-long struggle by the Marcoses to reclaim their political glory. CNN highlighted how Marcos Jr. praised his late father in his inaugural address. The cable news network also noted how the inauguration restored one of the Philippines' most notorious political dynasties to political dominance. And Channel News Asia describes Marcos Jr.'s inaugural address as a stirring speech that echoed his campaign slogans of unity. Rodrigo Duterte now back in Davao City after turning over the Philippine presidency to Ferdinand Marcos. Duterte's commercial flight arrived at the Davao City International Airport on Thursday evening, where a water salute was done as a tribute to the former chief executive. A homecoming concert was also held for him, but before his exit from Malacañang, he made an appeal to Filipinos to support his successor. Pia Gutierrez has this report.
36 years after his family was ousted from Malacañang, Ferdinand Marcos Jr. finally returns to the palace, this time as the 17th president of the Philippines. Following the tradition of those who came before him, Marcos Jr. first went to Malacañang Thursday morning to meet with his predecessor, Rodrigo Duterte, a symbol of a peaceful transition of power between the incoming and outgoing leaders. Marcos Jr. arrived at the palace a few minutes before 10:30 in the morning, where he was greeted by Duterte on top of the palace staircase. From here, Marcos Jr. signed the palace guestbook, his name and signature being the last entry for the Duterte administration. The mood between the two leaders was cordial and cheerful, despite Duterte calling his successor a spoiled brat and weak leader months earlier. The meeting, however, lasted less than 10 minutes, after which they both descended the grand staircase and into the Kalayaan grounds, where Duterte was given his last honors as President of the Philippines. Had the tradition been followed, the outgoing president would have accompanied his successor all the way to the inaugural venue, where he would be given his last honors, signaling the end of his term and a return to his life as an ordinary citizen. Duterte, however, did not follow this tradition, choosing instead to leave from Malacañang after a quick goodbye to the members of his cabinet. Marcos Jr. then proceeded to the National Museum without his predecessor. In an earlier video, however, Duterte expressed his support for the new administration as he urged the public to help Marcos Jr.
Let us give all our support to the new administration. Tulungan natin sila. Tulungan natin sila.
Meanwhile, prior to his return to Davao City on board a commercial flight, the former president spent his first hours as Citizen Digong by going to a mall in Makati. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
Public utility vehicle drivers not satisfied with the latest 2 peso fare hike granted by transport regulators. This report from Lady Vicencio.
The 2 peso fare hike for public utility jeepneys will be implemented across the country on July 1st. Base fare will be at 11 pesos in Metro Manila, Region 3 and 4. For modern jeepneys, minimum fare nationwide will be at 13 pesos. But for many jeepney drivers, the fare increase is hardly enough. Public utility drivers argue a meager fare adjustment will not offset the soaring cost of fuel and basic needs.
Yung diesel natin, ma'am, nasa mga 90 plus na, ma'am, eh. Tapos, ma'am, yung pasahero, madalang. Parang wala din nangyari.
Ang provisional increase po na hinihingi nila based on the omnibus motion that they filed last June 23 was a 2 pesos na provisional increase. So,
kumbaga,
nung June 8, they were already given 1 peso. So, ang dinagdag natin ngayon, 1 peso na lang for NCR, Region 3, and Region 4.
Transport group Piston believes a number of jeepney drivers who changed livelihood because of rising oil prices might return behind the wheel. A commuters group agrees with the fare hike, but more needs to be done to help the transport sector.
Kung sa amin po ay maluwag namin tinatanggap yan, pero dahil po naiintindihan din po namin ang tunay na kalagayan ng drivers, ang inaasahan po namin din ay maging 12 pesos. Dahil nga yung computation yan, lumalabas po na ang kanilang, ang idinagdag lang natin sa pang-araw-araw na kanilang kita ay 5 liters. Kulang pa rin yung idinagdag natin.
But not all passengers welcome the fare adjustment, saying any increase is an expense they can do without.
Malaking bagay na po. Parehas ko po, eh, tatlong sakay.
Pag kinumpit po yun sa loob ng isang buwan, malaking bagay rin po sa budget po sana namin. Yan ba sa amin po ng mga nagtatrabaho, malaking bagay rin pong pandagdag sa pangkain namin po yun.
Transport regulators have yet to decide on fare hike petitions for taxis, TNVS, and buses, which will now be decided on by the Marcos administration. Lady Vicencio, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippines joins 25 other countries in the biennial Rim of the Pacific drills. It's deemed as the world's largest international maritime exercise. The BRP Antonio Luna, a guided missile frigate, will be participating on behalf of the Philippine Navy. The U.S. Navy says the drills will give participating countries the opportunity to refine individual and combined maritime abilities and help promote a free and open Indo-Pacific. The maritime drills will be conducted in and around the Hawaiian Islands and Southern California until August 4. It comes amid China's rising influence and aggression in the West Philippine Sea. The Philippines records 1,309 new COVID-19 cases on Thursday. That's the highest single daily tally in over 4 months, or since February 25, and pushes the number of active cases to nearly 8,000. Metro Manila accounted for almost half of the new infections. The health department also reported 13 additional COVID deaths. COVID-19 cases in Europe also on the rise. The World Health Organization warns the region could see high levels of infections this summer. That's from June to September this year. The UN agency cites the lifting of COVID-19 restrictions for the expected increase. Based on its data, COVID cases have already tripled in the past month, with the region currently registering under 500,000 cases daily, up to just around 150,000 at the end of May. We're taking another break. When we return, Chinese President Xi Jinping returns to Hong Kong after 3 years. Head Start, we'll be right back. Welcome back. The U.S. Supreme Court deals a blow to the Biden administration's battle against climate change. The High Court on Thursday ruled the government's key environmental agency does not have the power to set sweeping caps on greenhouse gases from coal-fired power plants. President Joe Biden had been hoping to use the Environmental Protection Agency to bring down emissions to meet global climate goals that was set in the 2015 Paris Agreement. Biden called the ruling devastating, but he vowed to take action and find ways to continue protecting Americans. The United Nations, meanwhile, called it a setback in the fight against climate change.
Decisions like today's in the U.S. or any other major emitting economy makes it harder to meet the goals of the Paris Agreement for a healthy, livable planet. This is a setback in our fight against climate change when we're already far off track in meeting the goals of the Paris Agreement. The Secretary General has said repeatedly that the G20 must lead the way in dramatically stepping up climate action.
Chinese President Xi Jinping makes his first visit to Hong Kong in about 3 years. Xi arrived in the Special Administrative Region on Thursday, where he met with Hong Kong Chief Executive Carrie Lam and other officials ahead of the 25th anniversary of the city's return to Chinese rule. He's expected to lead the celebrations today, Friday, and inaugurate Hong Kong's new government. The move is seen to showcase the Chinese Communist Party's power over the business hub 3 years after it unleashed a harsh crackdown on pro-democracy protesters. Xi claimed Hong Kong has been reborn, and with the one country, two systems policy firmly in place, its future will be better. And that's the Head Start today. I'm Stanley Palisada. Thank you so much for watching. Stay informed. Stay with ANC.
Mobility.